Welcome to Wood for the Trees number 10. My name's Charly Le Marchant. This is a series all about woods and trees and tree planting. We're here today at the Knepp estate to talk about how trees fit into the Rewilding story. And we're meeting Alistair Driver of Rewilding Britain.
Trees and scrub are an essential part of a natural, healthy ecosystem in temperate Britain. We need pockets of rewilding, connecting and buffering a nature-friendly landscape.
Can you tell us what rewilding is? Is it just leaving nature to its own devices?
Well, the shortest definition I can give you is the large-scale restoration of ecosystems to the point where nature is allowed to take care of itself. Because we live in such a degraded landscape, centuries of impact by man, we need to intervene to kickstart the recovery of natural processes, to kickstart that recovery of the ecosystem. There are always lots of interventions that one can consider to initiate a rewilding program. So it's certainly not about land abandonment at this point in time, but it is about over time gradually relaxing on the management, not being prescriptive about what you want to see where, allowing nature to lead the way, but you've got to give it a kick start. I describe it as a marathon with a sprint start.
Can you tell us what part trees play in the rewilding process? Are there any times you would plant trees in a rewilding situation?
Trees and scrub are an essential part of a natural, healthy ecosystem in temperate Britain. But we've cleared so much of the landscape historically. It's essential that we encourage their recovery as part of rewilding schemes. We want to restore a natural, healthy, functioning ecosystem, and trees have a vital part to play in that. The question then is, okay, how do you go about that? Do you need to plant, or can you allow natural regeneration? And that the answer to that depends on where you are in the country. It depends on the proximity of good tree seed sources, the variety of those sources. It depends on local climate, topography, how harsh the environment is. Down here in the warm southeast, in a very treed landscape, natural regeneration is the way to go, and Knepp's proven that. You don't need to plant here. Trees will find their way, and it's a fantastic example of that. Some of the places I'm dealing with in northern England, not a chance of getting trees back in that landscape in 100 years, because there's nothing there. But there were trees there once, so planting or assisted regeneration is essential. Approximately 50% of the 30-odd projects in England, large-scale projects in England that I'm now dealing with, are planting trees as part of their interventions to kickstart rewilding.
What do you think of the government's tree planting targets?
Well, the government's tree planting targets are, to be honest, woefully short of what they need to be. You know, we really should be aspiring to something like around 25-30% tree cover in this country. That is entirely possible without it compromising existing food production. And it's entirely possible with the expansion in population and development. However, we are where we are. It is challenging enough to, you know, to deliver a couple of percent increase. We need to crack on with that whilst people like myself and organisations like Rewilding Britain and others keep pressure on government to be more ambitious as time passes. We are moving in the right direction with policy. We're not moving fast enough, and we're not being bold enough.
During our series, we've been talking to professional foresters. It seems to be important to manage woodland, especially for biodiversity. Can you talk about the biodiversity in a rewilding situation?
Management is only essential to maximise biodiversity or to optimise biodiversity if you haven't got all of the right pieces of the jigsaw in place. If you're rewilding at scale and you've got all the right mix of herbivores in that environment, and I mean things like bison, elk, beavers and boar, which would have been here naturally, and ideally you have the predators that control them, or if not, you are controlling those herbivores in a similar way to the predators. If you had all that in place, then no, management is not essential, because that's not the way nature does it. There's plenty of forests all over the world, which are very healthy and very biodiverse, which are not managed. But those foresters are referring to a managed environment within which it is necessary to manage a woodland to maximise the biodiversity value.
Grey squirrels and deer are causing a lot of issues for those planting trees. How do you manage this in a rewilding setting?
I know that there are places where landowners consider grey squirrel and deer to be an issue, and I've certainly seen places where deer are an issue. In terms of rewilding landscape, I've not yet come across a situation, and I've seen thousands of sites across the country in my 40 plus years. I've never yet come across a situation where grey squirrels are significantly impacting the biodiversity of an area over and above other forms of impact. Deer, definitely, yes, I've seen that. Cases where the understory is completely gone, completely bare, because of large numbers of deer and the absence of lynx and wolf. You know, it is necessary to intervene. We will need to intervene in that situation. We will have to be the wolf or be the lynx. And coming back to grey squirrels, though, you know, we prefer, from a Rewilding Britain perspective, we would prefer to advocate the restoration of the pine marten to various parts of the country. It's already happening. It's already proving very successful. We know that pine marten reintroductions or increase in pine marten populations lead to reductions in grey squirrel populations. And where there are red squirrels nearby or present, the red squirrels' numbers are starting to increase.
Do you believe that a truly multi-purpose woodland with biodiversity, ecological protection, public access and timber production is a realistic possibility? If so, could such woodlands be blended at a landscape level?
Yeah, I do think that there is scope for these multi-purpose woodlands. And, you know, Rewilding Britain, we're promoting the idea that there can be sustainable timber production from woodlands, just as there can be sustainable food production in a rewilding site. Now, it's not going to be pure rewilding. You've got to remember it's a spectrum of activity. And there are very few sites at the top end of that spectrum in this country. And most of those near the top end are in Scotland. Most of the sites are more in the Knepp model, which is lower down the rewilding spectrum, where, as you know, they're harvesting animals here, you know, to meat, high quality meat, small quantities to eat. And there's no reason why that can't be done with some of the timber in this landscape, roughly replicating a cycle of trees coming and going. The economics of these sites is not just about one thing. It's multiple sources of income that drive these rewilding projects. And timber, small quantities of sustainably, very sensitively harvested timber and timber products, no problem at all.
In a country that imports 70% of its food and 80% of its building timber, there's a lot of pressure to increase the amounts that we grow and produce. How does that fit in with your aim to rewild more of the land in the UK?
Yeah. Well, so the first thing is to put this in context. Quantities. Put these quantities in context. Rewilding Britain has an aspiration of 5% of Britain to be rewilded. Second thing is the current percentage is less than 1%, tiny percent. 70% of Britain is farmland. That's the first thing to say, 70% versus less than 1%. So just redressing that balance a little, surely that's doable, when you remember that we are wasting 40% of the food that farmland produces. So it's a pretty straightforward calculation to say, well, if we were more efficient and effective with the food we produce, we could spare a little bit more land for rewilding. The second thing to say is rewilding still produces food. As I said, it's not in England and Wales, it's not pure rewilding in most cases. It still needs these grazing animals because we don't have the native wild big herbivores and carnivores anymore. So we're harvesting them. And the same applies to timber. We can still produce small quantities of timber from this land. We're not giving up huge areas of forestry to do this. I can't, off the top of my head, think of any of the 30 rewilding sites in England that are demolishing huge areas of forestry. I can think of one or two very small plantations that are past their sell-by date. But frankly, there is not a conflict here. There is the space if we are more strategic about our land use and more efficient with our consumption of these products. If we did that, we wouldn't need to import nearly as much.
Can you tell me about the land that's most suitable for rewilding and where that land might come from in the future?
Yeah, the decision about what sort of land is suitable is kind of linked to being more strategic and more efficient and effective with how we manage land. And that's because the most appropriate place for rewilding is on that land, which is very marginal in terms of its current food production or its current timber production, and is probably being propped up by government subsidies that you and I pay for, and actually doesn't work without that subsidy. much better actually to diversify and find multiple ways of receiving income, not only for the landowner, but for the community as a whole in those areas. So most of the rewilding, the vast majority of it, happens on poor quality, poor grade land, just as here at Knepp, you know, really heavy clay soils. They tried farming for decades and it just couldn't make it work. And they decided to take that brave decision and go into this diversification approach, part which is centered on a rewilding principles, and as you know from the story, it's paying off. And these are not alone, by the way. You know, I've just come today from a site very like it, same sort of soil, heavy clay soils. They've been inspired by Knepp. Most of the landowners I've seen around the country, private landowners, have been inspired by this story and are now embarking on the journey.
Can you tell me about the sources of revenue for rewilding and whether rewilding is heavily dependent on government funding?
Anyone who's rewilding needs to explore multiple strands of income. Certainly you can't put all our eggs in one basket. There is not going to be enough money under the future ELMS scheme, the Environmental Land Management Scheme, to reward all of those people who want to rewild or go into nature-friendly farming. So you need to look at other options, and the other options include standalone grant schemes like the Nature for Climate Fund, which Rewilding Britain actually helped to get approved by government. There are woodland grant schemes. We've now, again, through our input, we've now got natural regeneration included in this new woodland offer, which is great. Then there are obviously the diversification opportunities, nature-based tourism, camping, glamping, safaris. There are products that can come from the land, wild food, timber, etc., that might come from the land. And then there are, as is the case with many large rewilding sites, large private rewilding sites, income from businesses that can exist in that location without impacting on the rewilding journey.
Can you tell me about your hopes and fears for the future of rewilding?
I guess my main hope for rewilding is it just carries on as it is, because the level of interest has gone through the roof in the last couple of years. But we need to make sure that government turns fine words into action now. We've persuaded government on several areas of policy in principle. Now they need to deliver on funding and hard policy and practice. In terms of the fears, not dumbing rewilding down, back down to just being nature conservation, traditional nature conservation. I've done, and I feel I can say this, because I've done traditional nature conservation for 40 odd years, and it's great, and I'm really proud of what I've been involved in, and all the thousands of people have done a great job, nature reserves, all these NGOs, brilliant job. Goodness knows where we'd be if we didn't have all of that, protected sites. But we need to understand that rewilding gives you something different, and we need both. We need all of this traditional nature conservation approach to carry on, but we need pockets of rewilding connecting and buffering a nature-friendly landscape. It is about relaxing, it is about working at scale, and it is about, you know, having an ambition but not being too prescriptive.
Alistair, if you could get one policy implemented by the government, what policy would that be?
I'm going to pick one that came up only yesterday. So somebody fairly senior in government asked me urgently for a specific policy ask, and that was that we become much more relaxed about species reintroductions. And actually, we know from recent experience of many species in this country that we can do it properly if we follow the right guidelines and we have a management strategy, mitigation strategy in place.
Something that really interests me is where humans fit into the rewilding landscape. Is there space for humans to be living amongst all that we've seen going on here today?
So I get asked quite a lot about the role of people and do people belong in this rewilding landscape? And the answer is yes, of course they do. It's quite simple. Homo sapiens is a species that belongs here in the natural environment. The question is, can we be there without detrimentally impacting on lots of other species and the environment as a whole? The answer to that is yes, we can if we want to. We know what we need to do. We know how we need to behave. Are we willing to make those changes to enable that to happen? We need people in this landscape. We shouldn't be abandoning areas of land and leaving the hills, fleeing the hills. We need communities in these rural areas. The challenge is to be there without stopping nature from flourishing.
Thank you, Alistair. That has been really informative.
It's been a real pleasure talking to you. Thank you very much.